Hello. Welcome to this short introduction into Goethe's way of science. We are here at Leapcroft, the Isle of Mull, the west coast of Scotland, in a Hebrides. I studied biology, geography and philosophy in Berlin. I worked as a high school teacher for a few years and then went into research. I did a PhD project at the University of Wittenherdecke about the healing plant mistletoe. And during that time I was employed at the Goetheanum. The Goetheanum is the center of the Anthroposophical Society in Dornach near Basel in Switzerland, which was founded by Rudolf Steiner. And it's called after Goethe. Goethe is not so well known in the UK, where we are, but he's also, even in Germany, he's not so well known as a scientist. He's well regarded as a poet. He was quite famous as a poet, still is today. But at this time when Goethe was alive, which is about 200 years ago, science was still quite a bit different from what it is today. Back then, just a few people were scientists. Nowadays we have hundreds and thousands and even millions of scientists, whole armadas of scientists. But one thing that is quite different today from the earlier days is that even though in the 100 years ago, 150 years ago, just a few people were scientists, the new discoveries and the progress in science was very fast. All the big, amazing scientific discoveries have been done by quite a few people. And nowadays we have so many scientists, but very little progress. So what is the big difference between back then and now? And I'm saying this as an introduction to the question why we might need a new perspective on science and why Goethe might be a leading figure for this question, because he had ideas about science which are quite unusual for mainstream science at the moment, which are more holistic, or one could say spiritual. If you, for instance, remember Darwin, the famous Darwin, whose contribution to science is undoubtedly very strong and important. He was self-funded. He funded his whole research by himself. And same was, for instance, with Goethe. He was lucky enough to have a very good employment as a statesman at a small principality of the Duke of Saxo-Weimar in the center of Germany, where he had lots of freedom, so he could not just write novels and plays, but where he could also do a lot of study and did his scientific works. Or Alexander von Humboldt. His big influence in science came about because he had the funds out of his family background. So that doesn't mean that back then all the good scientists were rich. It means that these scientists were independent. They didn't need to get money, they didn't need to get funding for their research. And that's the big difference to today. Even though we have so many, lots of people doing research, they're all depending on funding, on state funding, on funding from institutions, from foundations, and that is a big problem. It has become a big problem. It doesn't need necessarily to be a big problem, but it is a problem because it biases the questions. It leads questions into a certain direction. So we're losing the big variety of different ways of asking or ways of looking, because with money flow, always interests are connected. Just so that you know, the next about 20 minutes will not just be theoretical, will not just be about Goethe's method. It will mainly be also a demonstration of how Goethe's way of looking at nature could look like or could work. So we'll go over now to the garden and have a plant study about daffodils. So what is special about Goethe's way of looking at nature? I mentioned before it's an holistic approach, and holistic doesn't mean it's just more knowledge added to what we already know. It means it includes perspectives which are not usually integrated in our academic science. For academic science, it's very important that we keep the object that we're looking at separate from us. Sort of we're looking at things and we're trying to keep the human being as a subject out of the observation. Because usually it's regarded that our subjectivity, our own beliefs, our own perspectives bias the insights. For Goethe, that's not the way to do it. Because he says we cannot really exclude the human being. Because we're always part of the experiment and we are actually the observer, and we rather have to learn to understand what's objective also in our own objective and our own perspective. So holistic means he includes the human being. He includes the human being as a physical being, like the outside world, as a sensual being with our sensual organs, which we use for observation. It's a method very strongly centered on sense observation. But it also includes human being as a being that has soul, like has an insight. So we use our insight also as a tool to gain insights of nature, about nature. And if we include ourselves, then we have the possibility to understand and to learn what connects us with nature, with any other being. And I would like to demonstrate that with the daffodil. I picked a few daffodils here. This is the native daffodil, which is native to the west coast of Scotland and to Western Europe. It's an Atlantic plant which really enjoys the meadows here, the lot of rain that we're having, and flowers before the new growth of meadows start, so it has the full attention of the sun. Yeah, I just picked some so it's easier to demonstrate, but of course this one is growing, similar to those more breeded varieties of daffodil. And one thing, of course, it grows in bulbs, so the bulbs are living under the earth, and in spring it grows out of the earth. And maybe let's just for a second follow one of these, because they are kind of real plants, they're growing still. So you see the flower is connected to one stem, so it's quite a strong uprightness in this growth here. And it can be quite windy here, and usually it doesn't break, so it's quite a strong stem. And you see here, when the wind is there, it's moving a little bit, so it's also a bit flexible, but it has this very strong tension and uprightness. But it doesn't grow completely upright. It's not like that, that it's straight up. It's slightly bent to the outside. And when we follow the growth, you can see in this one here, when it's growing, it's really growing upright. And just later on, it develops this little bend here, and only when it's opening, you see here, this one's not quite open, it starts to bend down, and only when it's completely open, it has this very specific gesture in this movement, that it's slightly to the outside, and then it's directing to the surrounding when it's opening up. So it's not a flower that looks up to the sky, is open towards the heavens which would be if it would be like that, but it's tilting to the side. And that's also quite specific. If we observe that, here we have quite many, they all express this, that they're not completely looking to the sides, but they're slightly tilted downwards. For instance, if you see here, it's not just facing you, it's going downwards a little bit. And these are gestures. And gestures are something that we know from our insides. We can call them soul gestures, or gestures that we can recognize because we are soul beings. And this is what's specific about Goethe's method now, that we're trying to describe anything in nature, any phenomena in nature, like a plant now as an example. We're trying to reproduce what we observe in our insides. So first thing is really a good observation, describing what you see, not judging what you see, not naming what you see with, for instance, scientific names. But you describe, for instance, the specific green, or the specific uprightness, or how the stem is growing. And by describing it, one notices, there's a resonance inside. Sort of, how is that uprightness, slightly bent? So rebuilding it inside means kind of you find something in yourself which also is doing that, or which can do that. And then when we look at this flower in detail, we can intensify this inner feeling of this gesture. What can we recognize in this, what is expressed in the forms in that flower? So it has these six petals, and these six petals are, they're actually quite exposed. They do something like that. They go to the outside and expose the flower. But they are just one part of the flower. It also has this tube, or corona it's called, inside. So it has like two parts in the flower. One part which is opening up to the surroundings, and one part which has this tube, and the tube is slightly bending towards the earth. And it's quite a long narrow tube which just opens towards the outside. And at the outside it has this wonderful kind of opening. And that's not the only thing, that's the forms, but it also has color. And color is also something that is very strongly related to our own soul life. Yellow has a different expression than, for instance, white, or this more orangey center that these other ones are having here. But this one is completely yellow, and this yellow is also differentiated. The outside is a bit lighter, and the inside is a bit darker. And the lighter color is the one that is opening, and the warmer yellow, the kind of deeper yellow, is the one that has this more enclosed gesture. But yellow as a color itself is quite a joyful color. It's a color that is kind of beaming, it's radiating, it's going to the outside, it's expressing joy. And that's also something very Goethean. If he is known as a scientist, he's known for his color theory, his dispute with Newton about color. And there he also describes the inner quality of colors. Because color, of course, it's something in the sensual world, but it's also like something, a color or shade of our innerness. And yellow, if we feel yellow, we feel joyful, we feel radiant, we want to almost explode or give away. And now if you look at, for instance, this white here, white is very different. White is almost not a color in that sense, because it doesn't express an intense inner soul life quality. White is very neutral. White is almost free from any personal soul expression. So it's very, it's innocent, it's clean and childlike. But here in this normal daffodil, we have this radiance. Unfortunately, we don't have any other colors here, but just imagine, for instance, a blue flower. Of course, blue flowers, they don't have this radiance, they don't have this joyful expression. Blue is rather a color that turns inward. So if you have a blue color, it's usually flowers that have something more more inner qualities or turning inwards qualities. Quite often also they're not like open and just like pointing to the heavens. But for instance, if you have aconites, they have they're actually closed. So even in the gesture of that aconite flower, which is dark blue, almost purple, you have this innerness. Or if you imagine the violet, it also you can't see the center of a violet. That deep violet color is almost is the form and the color that belong to each other, that suit each other. So let's go a bit deeper. What kind of gesture could be expressed here in this flower? And that's now a crucial point where most scientists would say, okay, that's really not what we want as scientists, because now science turns or flips inside towards the human being and turns out to be about learning something about yourself. Because now if you want to see what kind of gesture is expressed here, we have to investigate ourselves. We have to research towards the inside to figure out, yeah, how does it actually feel to express these forms of that flower? And I'll just give you a brief hint. Of course, it only works if you're trying to reproduce these forms in yourself. Otherwise, it stays stale if I just tell it. But you can try to follow what I say. So if you have this opening, if you feel like really opened to the surrounding, not to the heavens, but towards something, toward the world around you, then you open. You want to be impressed, or you want to impress. But that's not the only thing here. It has this tube, and this tube has something a bit secretive. There is something inside which you don't quite see. I mean, of course, we can look inside, but the secret is hidden a little bit. Usually, they're growing in a way that you can't look inside. So it has something like a secret or something inner in itself, which is hidden. And that's a very interesting tension between this completely being open and being joyfully exposing yourself to the surroundings and having this this secret. So the question would be, do we know this from ourselves? Is that a gesture or a feeling that we can feel? And daffodils, maybe we could say, we have feelings that are more with the surrounding, and we have feelings which are more with ourselves. And here we have both. And we can have these both things, for instance, when we admire something. Because admiration means that my whole inner life goes towards what I'm admiring, sort of I'm opening up, and I'm totally overwhelmed by the beauty of the thing that I'm admiring. But the admiration also has something that I want to have for myself, or that I want to be like that. I want to really feel like the person or the thing that I'm admiring. Well, there is this kind of inner thing, this longing maybe, but also this totally going for what is there. Yeah, this is just kind of very short introduction into researching this. A proper Göttingen study would be to describe the whole plant, describe every organ of the plant, and do it really systematically. Also, for instance, what helps is to draw. Goethe also was a very good painter. He painted a lot because if you, for instance, paint the daffodil, that really helps you to go all into the gestures and expressions of the plant, because when you draw it, it helps you to actually realize what you haven't seen yet. Because when you draw it, you have to decide what you're drawing. And by just looking at it, one has the impression, okay, now I've seen it. But quite often what we see is very superficial. So Goethean approach would be quite structured, quite disciplined, to go through different steps. If we sum up what Goethe would do when he would look at plants, is written down here. It's four stages, four steps. One follows through them. We did them outside, just with the daffodil. The first one is actually the longest and the most difficult one. It's called exact sensory observation. Because the more exact you are in what you describe, what you really see, because it's there, it corrects you. There's truth in it. The more correct and exact you're also in the following stages. So from step one to step two is already happening kind of a shift towards the inside. You're trying to follow the movements of how that plant was growing or how it's expressing itself in its forms. So you use your inner capacities by kind of recreating inwardly how that plant is growing. Then the third stage would be to trying to feel or to deepen these impressions by asking yourself what kind of soul gestures are expressed in these movements. And then the last stage, kind of the the most critical one, because here if something is happening, like the identity, or you ask yourself how does it feel like to be that plant, or do you actually try to be that plant, and by being it you experience how that plant is, what it's about, and this could be experienced as something not appropriate, because here we are really very much in danger of just interpreting what we are seeing. And it shouldn't be just an interpretation, it should really be an impression, taking insight of what you see outside and finding the correlation between what's inside of man and outside in nature. And to be more clear about this point, it's always helpful to go back to stage one, to go deeper and really study what's there. Go back to movement, go back to gestures, deepening these gestures, and only if you have a rich, full impression of that, you should go to stage identity. So I was suggesting outside that the daffodil is expressing something like adoration. And if that wouldn't feel totally convincing, the exercise would be to go back to the start. So how is that adoration really about? Because adoration is still, in a way, something artificial. Adoration can have so many different shades, so many different expressions. And you actually see in daffodils, there's just a few here, that it is also expressed in nature in many different ways. You can have the big yellow adoration, you can have the pure white adoration. Some daffodils have this strong orange inside, so that's a much deeper adoration. So you have all these different varieties, different expressions. Okay, and now I want to go back to also summing up what Goethe's interesting approach towards science is here. Because he's overcoming the dogma of separation. That might be this the spiritual significance of Goethe, because usually when we have a normal classical science, which is we haven't left here in stage one, we have the subject as a person who's doing the observation, and we have the object which we are observing. So we have two different things. And already in stage two, something is happening that can be symbolized as that we are still the subject and there's still the object, but we're taking something from the object inside and starting a conversation with the outside. So by recreating these movements inside, this is starting to overlap. And a gesture, this is even stronger. This could be symbolized as something like that. We are really connecting with the outside. There's this very large overlapping. And in stage four, identity, this has become one. So if we really succeed with that stage four, if we are the plant, then we are just one. We can't separate ourselves from the external world. And that's what's spiritual in this approach. It is about oneness. It is about meeting the other being as an inside experience. And yet it is scientific, because it is not just up to everyone to do it however they want to do it. It has a very very strict method which you can follow. And it always can be corrected by going back to stage one, a very good, exact observation and description of what you see. Goethe is really about connection, making a connection with the outside world. And that connection is a meeting. And a meeting, if it's a true meeting, is not just that two things meet, it's that two things change each other. So if I become a little bit more like a daffodil, I am a different person afterwards. If one reads Goethe in his original writings, I have to admit that Goethe did not do what we just did like that. Because Goethe was mainly an artist soul. So he was all about exploring, he was going in all different directions with his explorations. He wrote a lot, but he wasn't a very, I would say, structured person how a good scientist is nowadays. So he didn't clarify what he did in a method that he expressed himself. So you can find this within all of his writings, his scientific writings, because he demonstrates that all the time. So you can find it in his writings, but you cannot find these four steps in his writings. So since Goethe, his way of science also was developed further. I was telling before, I was working at the Goetheanum, which is a Steiner place, and Steiner, before he started to become an anthroposophist and to start with anthroposophy, he was for almost 20 years a Goethe researcher and a Goethe publisher, and he published Goethe's scientific writings. And Steiner developed out of all these Goethe, out of all his Goethe studies, a theory of knowledge of Goethe's worldview. And this is, so I have to say, like a combination of Goethe, but a little bit interpreted through Steiner. And Steiner's also 100 years ago, there's been quite a number of Goethean scientists that call themselves Goetheanistic scientists, who also developed this method further. And especially this
flower gesture observations is something that was developed by Ernst Michael Kranich, a scientist who died just a few years ago. So Goethe is really about connection and finding these connections to the world by including the soul capacity into the scientific process.
We are recording this video at Easter, and as far as I understand, Easter it's a celebration of death and rebirth. But not just a rebirth in a way something dies and is alive again, but there's something happening in between death and the resurrection, a transformation. And this is pretty much, I think, what Goethe's alternative to science is about. Is you need to understand that science, with all its great wonders and amazing insights that it brought us, it also brought us to this crucial situation which we are in this dreadful situation our planet is in, because of the dogma of separation, which is the fundamental worldview of academic science. And we need to overcome this. And one way to overcome it is by integrating soul and to reconnect by our own capacities, inner capacities, with the inner quality that lives also in nature. And that is what Goethe is about, and that is what I was hoping to demonstrate here and give you a short taste of. When we integrate soul, also ethics find its place again in science. And if ethics, if morality becomes part of the scientific endeavor, the laboratory, the table of the science lab, that's what Steiner once said, is becoming the new altar. It's becoming a sacred act. And then healing can take place again.